Hey guys, I'm Sean Larkin. So today we're going to talk about DAMP. DAMP coding practices, DAMP programming. Have any of you guys heard of it before? Anybody? Okay, cool. So I guess just a little bit of information about myself. I'm currently a UI UX developer at Info Group in Pavilion. We work with business-to-business, business-to-consumer data, and I'm in charge of working front end of their products. So, a little bit about myself. Initially, I didn't really imagine I'd ever become a software engineer web developer. I was a technical support over at Mac Practice down the street. And I decided to kind of go against the grain and start training myself to do some coding practices, Objective-C, JavaScript, Rails, Ruby, and some JavaScript as well. And now I am here today after 3.5 years as a developer. I worked at a few places, but some things about me: I love AngularJS, I like ReactJS, but, they're both great. They're both great. We can discuss why I think Angular is better. Anyway, I'm a huge readability junkie, and like to see there, I've written in a variety of languages. And I'm also an urban chicken farmer, so if you guys want to get some eggs, So I came across a quote on a Medium post, I think earlier today, and it's, "Nobody is a worse programmer than your past self." So just think about that as we're going through here today, and why it's so important that you learn about it. So, like I said, at Mac Practice, the first thing I did as I was a software engineer is I wanted to learn as much as I could and kind of fit in. And so some of the acronyms, you know, the two first acronyms I ever learned while they were throwing these terms around was wet and dry. Do you guys know what any of that means? Or how it relates to growing? There you go. So the first one, don't repeat yourself. It's not only applying to coding, but it's philosophy. First point, the pragmatic programmer. It basically aims to eliminate as much repetition as possible, and not only your databases, your networks, every line of code you write, or any technical system. So as you can see there, every piece of knowledge must have a single, unambiguous, authoritative representation within the system. It's a big deal. Essentially, you want it to no duplication. You want to be able to make one change to one source and have it affect the way that you want any part of your system. So, the other one is wet. No, wet. We enjoy typing. So, there's actually a couple acronyms for this one. I've also heard write everything twice. And essentially, it's the opposite. Most people use the term when you don't write dry enough code. And so, you know, you'll have duplication, multiple sources of knowledge. And there's actually some people who believe that this is an okay practice. Here would be an example in JavaScript. I think this came out of a snippet from my previous job at Angel. We were writing a category class which had a nested category in it. And so, before I wanted to access any properties of it, I wanted to make sure that it was instance of a category. At least so that way we could gracefully throw an error or whatever. As you can see here, the exact same lines of code are basically being used to validate the type. So that's a great example of that. Dry would say, take that block of code and isolate it to one source. So instead of having two times here, or repeating yourself, you instead just have a function that you can call in both places. If you need to, now keep in mind this is just a abbreviated version of this code. It's got a lot more prototype methods, which I think 10 or 20 times I have that block of code in there. And so even every day I try it, I struggle to remind myself, or I try to remind myself that dry is the way to go. Now that's just my opinion. So what?
Yeah, I haven't talked about the end.
I like to give a little primer one because it kind of ties into my story. So as I was looking, doing the Googling on wet and dry, I came across a Stack Overflow response about NAMM. And so before we start, it's not halfway between wet or dry, but it can complement wet or dry philosophies and programming. But they don't interfere. So you could be a damp programmer, and you could, still adhere to the dry or wet philosophy. So what is what? Okay, so damp applies to how you name all the things. So methods, functions, arguments, class names, file names. It stands for descriptive and meaningful phrases. Basically, in short, it promotes the readability of code. So as you can see here, Chris Edwards was the answer on that Stack Overflow question. I'll remember to post that. That's where I found it. So to maintain code, you first need to understand it. To understand it, you need to be able to read it. So just think for a moment, how much time have you guys wasted or spent reading code? It's a lot. Damp increases that maintainability by reducing the time necessary to read and understand the code. So like I said, to maintain your code, you gotta understand it. And to understand it, you gotta read it. It has to be readable. So, how many times have you guys seen something like this where it could have been written by yourself, come back and realize, what the hell is going on here? Like, what is this code? Like, what is this person doing? So here we have, you just kind of soaked in this example. It's really short, it's really simple, and yeah, maybe if you, most developers could figure out what this means. So could your project manager, your business analyst, could the QA developer who's working with you understand it? This is what I think when I see that code. What's data for? What does it represent? What kind of data is being logged? Log data is the file name. What does it mean? I understand that there's a log and there's data, but it doesn't tell me a story about what this code's trying to accomplish. And even in here, the arguments. If you didn't understand what those two arguments represented, where it's the iterator and the index, you'd have no idea what's happening. And so let's get damp. Let's do it. So let's just say that you have an array of child ages, and you want to go through and pass it to a function, which logs into the console for you. Well, if you had, let's just say we stripped the guts out of this code, most likely you'd still be able to understand what's going on. I can tell that we have an array of child ages, and that it's going to log each of those data points. And that we're calling it. It's a simple concept, but it's powerful. Anybody, a mom, neighbor down the street, could look at this and say, I think I understand what's going on. So I took another example from an Angular directed controller that I wrote for predictive search. So I just want you guys to take a look at some of the, I like to say, obnoxiously long naming conventions. But at any time, do you not know what's happening? Everything from functions to the arguments themselves. Obviously, I stripped out the threads, but even the name of the function itself. The file is called HN predictive search. So really, if somebody before you or somebody after you needs to come in and take a look at this code, they'd be able to. Even your future self, be able to do that. So why do NAMP? Why? Well, your code becomes a story. Like I said, if we take a look again, instead of thinking about it as lines of code, just thinking about it as meaningful phrases. So I have a variable here that is the input value, is pre-filled from NTT frames. So a lot of times, in keywords, where you see is or should or does, you know this is going to be true or false, yes or no. As far as looking at callbacks, you have requests did respond with success, requests did respond with error. So keeping it meaningful is important because you're telling the story. It's more than just code. And you write less. I think, if you think, I mean, how many times have you opened up a file in which you have 100 lines of code or 50 of its comments and then unlegible namespaces? When I look at that, my eyes just kind of gloss over. And it stays readable, and because it's readable, it's meaningful. So who does it? Who does it? So that kind of gets to the end of my story where, as I found Dan, at MacPractice, we were working on Apple products, making Mac native applications for medical management software. And so working in Objective-C and a really robust 2 to 3 million line code, I noticed something, and it kind of dawned on me. Apple does it. If anybody here code in Objective-C, I was going to ask you directly Objective-C program. Take a look at some of these method names and interface names. AV capture manual exposure brackets still image settings. It's long, but I know exactly what's happening. And all of you should know exactly what's happening. Yeah, it's a lot of typing, but in the end, when you come back, it's out of the game. Most of the time, when my dear is, and in your text editors today, most of the things you're writing or retyping are out of the game. So, something to leave, you know, something to leave you with. But again, I took, you know, out of Objective-C right now these principles and just applied it to everything else that I do. But it just makes me think of this one thing. I should have just made that slide for it. Wow. Nobody's a worse programmer than your past self. The biggest times I've, you know, WTF moments has been when I've gone back to my code 3 months ago and been like, what the hell was I thinking? But when you write damn coding, you use descriptive meaningful phrases. It all comes together. And you don't really have this problem. At least with the names. So, I'll give just a little bit of an example. Kind of interactive, I suppose. But why don't we just take like an operating lane computer. It's so fancy. Just use code. So, somebody name a project that you guys are working on or a specific, you know, feature.
Amazing simple system.
Huh?
Amazing simple system. We actually have simple system.
Amazing super system.
Yes.
What does it do?
It's a simple system. It's amazing. Well, no, it's a new platform.
Okay.
The simple system is a part of that.
So what does it try to accomplish?
It's a platform.
Okay. Platform for what?
For hosting applications.
Okay. So the naming conventions that I like to say, and use whatever language you want. I'm just using JavaScript just because I've been doing JavaScript for the last few years. So the first kind of step that I like to take is to always prefix my names with the, you know, kind of put your tag on it, your company's tag, your product's tag. You know, at Haney, we did HN. At MacPractice, it was MD. And this is a coding convention that sticks with iOS Objective-C. But it just makes sense. You can identify the difference between your functions or core functions. Let's say it's written in Node, super system, web hosting platform server. All you have to say is, what are you trying to accomplish? What does it do? And you literally have the instructions on how you're supposed to name all your things. Let's hear another example. A product that anybody's working on? Oh, I know all New York, huh? Is video or is it in the video? Is it video? So it doesn't have to be extremely complex, but you just have to get the point across. Anybody else? Any other projects or anything? What about a function that you just worked on today? Yeah, if you're right in Objective-C, there are in the industry. What's the last function that somebody worked on today?
Get data.
What kind of data? That's actually a perfect example. That's a perfect example. All right. So we know what that does?
I have no idea what get data does.
What kind of data is it?
It's configuration data.
Configuration data? Well, what are we configuring?
Wow.
You don't have to give away company secrets.
No, it's not company secrets. I lost some words to describe what it is that we're configuring.
Really?
But it's, yeah. Let's just take it as configuration data.
Okay. I kind of want to know what kind of configuration it is.
application configuration data.
Okay. Is it the application that's being posted by a server?
Yep.
Okay. Let's do this. We'll do it in Objective-C. Help us write an example of maybe a function. Or what the name would be. I will. Oh, magnify. So what do we got here? So in Objective-C, they use brackets, I don't know if anybody knows. And we can do another example. But we have SS web hosting platform server name. We consider that our class, our object, our namespace. We know exactly what it's doing. And the function that it's trying to call is get application configuration data. So I hope that makes sense to you guys. In a day and age, you know, I'll kind of close it up and wrap it up, but in a day and age where we have compilers that minify and optimize our code, strip out namespaces for symbols, obfuscated code, for performance, there's no reason that we shouldn't be able to be descriptive, not only for your own sake, but for the rest of the people that are going to try and fix or use or enhance your code. So, if you haven't checked out Objective-C at all, give it a try. You'll see that, you'll see that this will kind of stick with you once you do so.
So if you have modules or namespaces, would you suggest writing your names in the contents of that module namespace?
Yeah. I mean, there's no reason not to.
I mean, it's safe to do paragraphs.
That's true. It would. Absolutely, it would. Does anybody else have any questions? Yeah.
True story. User hit the cancel button.
That's and perfect, though.
It started a debate within the shop because a couple of coders were absolutely derisive and saying, I was told we were to provide something like that, and it was a horrible travesty. Good people said, it's not so bad for Google because we only have to type it a couple of times. It's not like it was a class namespace, it's going to be have to retype it several times a lot. And the consensus was that, it sort of came down from on high that this was a dumb idea and you should just say cancel. So we have cancel. But I made the argument that if we had an editor take a long name and a nickname, in other words, I don't mind writing a short variable name or nickname that people type out, as long as I hit some button somewhere that takes some short names, it turns into a long name. Partly with spaces, I don't know if anybody's working with PCL language, but you can name variables with spaces instead of a camel case. Which does is you get lots and lots of variables going by. A camel case really doesn't make it hard to read.
Yeah.
And very thin. In some languages, you can have spaces in your markings. And I think some, I'm not sure if it's true in JavaScript, but there is a non breaking space character. So if your language supports UTF characters, as long as I can hit some button that shows me the long one, and then I hit another button and it's a short thing. And we usually type a short thing. Everybody seemed to think that would be a good idea, except we were using different languages, so we had to do that. But that was the consensus. And nobody likes using the canceled button.
That's true. And you know what? I can understand where the optimization, you know, where short names, namespaces, anything, short all the things, was necessary because they didn't have these compilation systems and everything they're working to optimize as much as possible. But that's not the case these days.
I think I can make kind of a counter argument. I think the descriptiveness of your name should be proportional to the size of the scope. So if you just have an iterator and it's inside a type portal, you know, a two-line portal, call it out. It's descriptive in its context. It doesn't live beyond, you know, that line of the field. But if you get something that's global, it should be very descriptive. Obviously, your name should be descriptive. But just as a general rule, size relative or proportional to the type of scope.
I mean, I can agree with that. I haven't worked where I need to use the more namespace style, doing like, you know, Angular or something like that, where I just have long functions or long variable names, but it's true. The whole point is not to just write long-ass names. It's to be descriptive. It's to be able so that anybody can write code. Just say, could my mom understand this code? Or, you know, no offense to your mom, she doesn't know code, but could anybody, could your future self, could, you know, you 20 years who can't code for scam or anything, could they read your code? And that's what's important.
I do think your point in the story, if you get tuning really, really long names, where you stop being able to cognitively track them, and if you've got really variable names, 10 of which start with I and they're all 50 characters long, along with a whole bunch of other names in there, you're reading a book and keeping track of characters and trying to remember which one's which, and they all start with the same letter, and if anyone's very clever, you apply. Seriously, you can keep track of the characters in there, and their names are shorter. There's more, but I think there's a trade off there that you can be as long as you need to be descriptive, but don't be any longer.
Well, yeah, sure. I mean, if you look, most of my code will never have, like, I might strip the cancel button, or I mean, any articles. I mean, really, you're right, it's meaning, it still has to be meaningful and necessary. And so, enough for you to understand, or a phrase for you to understand what it's trying to accomplish, without having too much fluff. I mean, for the most part, if you look, you know, I use Apple or Objective-C as the golden standard. And so, you know, if you capture manual exposure brackets still in existence, or settings, you know exactly what it is. Maybe it's not the way you, you know, say it in a formal sentence, but you know what that was going on. So, any other questions?
Just to add to the book metaphor, you know, books got a lot of characters is one thing, but if Miller is a Miller and Taylor is a Taylor, then you'll remember who's who. So even if really long names, I mean, yeah, you're reading a book, but you're probably more likely to remember the characters if their name is more than just a name. That's, I think,
you know how to read a book. It's a story. It doesn't have to be code. I guess, you know, the last thing will be this. I stumbled across this while working on just a blog covering this exact same thing. And I think the first thing it says there, ignore the second one, just for the sake of my opinion. A system of words, letters, figures, or other symbols substituted for other words, letters, especially for the purposes of secrecy. That's why I don't like to call it code. Because that's not the point. That's not the point. Our compilers can take care of that. So just, you know, remember that. When you're writing code, write a story. But that is it. Thank you, guys.